Good morning. Are you scared now? You should be. Grab your Bibles. We ready to open up God's Word? No. Are we ready to open up God's Word?
Yeah.
Okay, much better. See, we just did a shout video and then you got quiet on me. I got to tell you, I am excited about this morning. You want to know why? Because we have had all kinds of technical difficulties this morning. And when that happens, that means the enemy is just on the warpath. He does not like what is about to happen, which means we're going to like what's about to happen, right? So open up your Bibles. We're going to be in Joshua chapter 6. While you're getting there, Gene, in all the madness this morning, forgot to mention, if you would like some information to get connected with the Harders, you can fill out this information. It includes your bank account number, so they can just do a direct... No. I don't know why I handed it to Gene. But be sure that you get in touch with them and they can keep you updated on everything that's going on there in Germany. And it's going to be good. All right. Did you see the video? What was all that about?
Shouting.
So this morning, you got to prepare. And my vocal cords are not good this morning again. Shocking, right? But we're going to be prepared to shout because we've come to that moment in the story of Joshua and the Israelites. There's been a lot of ramping up, hasn't there? There's been a lot of on the other side of the Jordan and getting prepared to jump and choosing God and spiritual markers once they got to the other side. And then last week was especially difficult, wasn't it? Do you remember what we talked? Min, you just blocked it out, didn't you? Talked about circumcision and how the Israelites had to be circumcised before God would allow them to engage in the battle. And we talked about our own spiritual circumcision, the same thing. We have to be sold out to God and to His covenant, the new covenant, before He'll allow us or before we should engage in the battle. Well, now it is finally time. We're 6 chapters in and it's time for the battle. Are you ready for the battle?
Yes.
You think the Israelites were ready for the battle?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, they got 40,000 men out front, trained men whose sole purpose is to engage in this battle, and it doesn't go exactly as planned. You know this story, don't you? We all know this story, right? But before we get into the part of the story that you really know, it's important that we read the first couple of verses because God gives the Israelites, and this is so important for the Israelites and for you and me. God gives the Israelites a promise. Are you ready for the promise? Now the gates of Jericho were tightly shut because the people were afraid of the Israelites. How many times have we heard that? The Israelites heard that they were afraid before they crossed the Jordan. They heard that they were afraid after they crossed the Jordan. And now Jericho shuts its gate. No one was allowed to go out or in. But the Lord said to Joshua, I have given you Jericho, its king, and all its strong warriors. What was the promise that God gave to the Israelites?
I have given you
Jericho. Now, you ready for your English lesson? This phrase, I have given you, is perfect past tense, which means it is already done. Not I'm going to give you Jericho, not you're going to win this battle, but I have already given you Jericho. What's the title of the sermon this morning?
Victory.
Victory. What God is saying to the Israelites up front is, I have already given you this victory. Now, if you know going into battle that you've already won, how should that make you feel? Pretty confident, yes? I mean, if you knew going into a sporting event, or you knew going into work, and maybe you've got some presentation that you may have to make, if you knew going into that, that it was going to succeed, that nothing was going to stand in your way, you might have a little confidence, yes? You might be sure that whatever was going to happen was going to be good. Well, that's exactly what God told the Israelites. Then after the promise, he gave them the plan. Now, what is the typical plan for attacking a walled city?
Battering
rams, a siege, usually engage at least some ladders, right? Yeah, not God. Listen to, okay, I've given it to you. And then you know the thing, right? You and your fighting men should march around the town once a day for 6 days. Seven priests will walk ahead of the ark, each carrying a ram's horn. And on the seventh day, you are to march around the town seven times with the priest blowing the horns. When you hear the priest give one long blast on the ram's horns, have all the people shout as loud as they can, then the walls of the town will collapse and the people can charge straight into the town. What was the plan? It is crazy. See, we hear this story so many times, we think what God tells the Israelites to do is normal. What did God tell the Israelites to do? Just walk. Now, first of all, if you're a fighting man, are you happy with this plan? Mm-mm. What do you want to do? I want to do something. I want to fix this. This is not how, in fact, there are probably some generals that came, I don't know this, but there might have been at least in their head some generals going, no, this isn't going to work. This is not how you, I know how to win a battle, and this is not it. God says, for 6 days, what are they supposed to do? March around the town. How many times? Just once. And what are they supposed to do while they're marching? This is important. Okay, the priests are going to blow the ram's horn. What are the people supposed to do? Totally silent for 6 days. Now, all that's supposed to happen is the priests will go. They will blow the trumpets the whole time. And the Ark of the Covenant will be among them. And both of those things are significant. What did the Ark of the Covenant represent? That's God's presence. What did the ram's horn, and the technical term, by the way, is a shofar. What did the shofar, the ram's horn, and blowing it represent? It meant announcing God's presence. When you heard the ram's horn, everyone in Israel thought, I need to pay attention because God is here. So you had two things, the ram's horn and the Ark of the Covenant. So they were supposed to be silent before God before anything ever happened. But on the seventh day, things were different. What are they supposed to do on the seventh day? March around seven times. And what are they supposed to do during the first six times at least? Silence again, the ram's horns are blowing. But the last time around, they're going to hear this one loud blast. What are they supposed to do? They're supposed to shout at the top of their lungs. Now, I think when we hear this, and I've given this message, but I've talked about Joshua chapter 6 before, but this part has escaped me before because I've always focused on, well, when you talk about Jericho, what do we always focus on? You know, the wall. And we talk about how big the wall was and how thick the wall was and how impossible what was about to happen was supposed to do. But I've never actually spent a whole lot of time thinking through what were they supposed to do here? What was God asking them to do? I've always thought it was crazy. What are they doing? They're doing a bunch of marching. And you know how this story ends. This is one of those, I can't surprise you. Oh, shocking. Right, so what the people do is exactly what God told them to. Joshua calls together them all, and he says, I want you to take the Ark of the Lord's Covenant and assign the seven priests to walk in front, and they're going to have ram's horns. And then he gave the orders to the people, march around the town, and the armed men will lead the way in front of the Ark of the Lord. And he goes through this whole conversation with them. But jump down to verse 10. He says, do not shout, do not even talk, not a single word from any of you until I tell you to shout, then shout. And so they did it. For 6 days, and you can read this, I'm not going to read it because it's actually kind of boring. For 6 days, they go out, they march, and they go back to camp. They go out, they march, they go back to camp. No, how many have I done? Three? Yeah. We've actually done this here. A few years ago, I'm not doing it now. I gave you all kazoos, and some of you weren't here. That's what I'm telling you. And so we actually stood up, and we marched around this building in silence, and then when we got back, we blew the kazoos. It was kind of fun. I reminded my daughter about that, and she said, yeah, that was kind of dumb. You know why she said that? Because it's weird. But I did it so that we got an idea of what it felt like. For 6 days, are they really doing it? What did they feel like? What would you feel like? They feel silly. This is weird. Really? This is what we're supposed to do? But they finally get to the seventh day, right? And now they know, okay, today is the day that something is going to happen. All this buildup. Today, God is going to, he's given us this town, and we followed all of his instructions, and they marched for 6 days, or six times around this thing. And then on the seventh, they blow the ram's trumpet, and then jump down to verse 16. The seventh time around, as the priests sounded the long blast on their horns, Joshua commanded the people, "Shout, for the Lord has given you the town. Jericho and everything in it must be completely destroyed as an offering to the Lord. Only Rahab the prostitute and the others in her house will be spared, for she protected our spies." He says, "I don't want you to take anything. Everything is marked for destruction. If you find silver or gold, I want you, or bronze or silver, that's God's stuff, and I want you to bring it into his treasury." Verse 20, "When the people heard the sound of the ram's horn, they shouted as loud as they could, and suddenly the walls of Jericho collapsed, and the Israelites charged straight in the into the town, capturing it, and they killed everything. They wiped everything out. They saved Rahab. They took all the gold and the silver and the iron, and they brought it to the treasury, and they burned the whole thing down, and then Joshua curses Jericho." And we get caught up in all of that excitement, don't we? I mean, that's pretty cool, isn't it? What brought the wall down? What didn't bring the wall down? What did not bring the wall down?
The shouting.
See, I think sometimes we get this wrong. You guys got it right. You're smart. We'll see how you stack up against second and third service. Don't tell them. The shouting did not bring the wall down. What brought the wall down? God did. God brought that wall down. So what was the shouting all about? What was the shouting for?
Obedience.
Is that what you said? Yeah, this is an act. Everything they're doing today, or in these 7 days, is an act of faith and obedience, isn't it? This is God said to do it, so we're doing it. And we're going to trust that what God tells us to do, you see how this sermon kind of writes itself? You see where we're going? When God says to move, what do? We move. When God says to do the crazy thing, what do? You do the crazy thing. When God says to do the simple thing, what do? This is where we get tripped up, right? March around a town. That's not going to work. What are you, nuts? That's too easy. We just want to march and then shout? What? Two important things for us. There wasn't just shouting. I think we focus on the shouting. What happened before the shouting? Before the trumpets? What happened to the people on days 1 through 6? What were they doing? They were obedient. How were they obedient? Oh, see, we don't even want to say it. It's like we block it out. What did they do for 6 days? And what didn't they do? They were silent before God for 6 days. They shouted for 5 seconds. They were silent for 6 days before God. Was the victory already theirs?
Yes.
Yes, they'd been given the town already. God said, "It's yours. What I want you to do is to be quiet before me. I want you just to be silent before me. I don't want you to fix this. I don't want you to tell me how you want it done. I don't want to hear plans. What I want is just for you to be with me in my presence in preparation for what's about to happen." And then the shouting is about victory. The shouting was, when do you normally shout? When the Broncos win a game, what do? I shout and I scream. You saw that shouting. It's a sign of victory. We want victory. We're claiming victory. And actually, this shout was known as a war cry and also a sign of victory. There's shouting that happens to say, we have won this battle. But what's weird about that is they shouted that they won the battle before the battle was won. When would we normally shout? When the wall falls. God said, I've already given you the victory. I want you to spend time in my presence, and then I want you to claim that victory by praising and worshiping me before it happens. And that timing is important for us. Because what if I told you God has given you the same promise? In fact, what if I told you God has given you a better promise than he gave the Israelites on this day? Would you be interested to hear that? Grab your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 8. I'm glad you're interested. Because otherwise, the rest of this is no fun. Romans chapter 8, verse 37. Here Paul is talking about all the things that might keep us from being close to God. He's talking about trouble and calamity and persecution and being hungry and being destitute, being in danger, or having your life threatened. And he says, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. Anyone ever had any difficulty in your life? As that's happened, have you ever thought, what am I doing wrong? Why is God against me? We get into Eeyore mode, don't we? God says, despite those things, you have victory. Not one amen. Okay, you're not convinced. That's okay. Jump over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Doing a sermon on shouting and you're being quiet. That's okay. We're in the 6 days. First Corinthians 15. I'm actually going to back up to verse 56. For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Anyone ever thought sin has power and control over me? God says he gives you victory through Jesus Christ over sin and death. Not just sin, over sin and death, you and I have victory. But you still might not be convinced, so keep going. 1 John chapter 5. And by the way, when God says something more than once, it's a good idea to pay attention. 1 John chapter 5, starting in verse 1. We're going to read 1 through 4. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has become a child of God, and everyone who loves the Father loves his children too. We know we love God's children if we love God and obey his commandments. Loving God means keeping his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For every child of God defeats this evil world, and we achieve this victory through our faith. And who can win this battle against the world? Only those that believe Jesus is the Son of God. You achieve victory in this world. Too many Christians walk around in defeat. Life is hard, yes? But the promise has already been given. You have victory in Jesus Christ. The walls are going to come down. The problem is we don't ever claim victory until we see it. Right? I don't know if God's going to bring that wall down. God said he was going to bring the wall down. God told the Israelites, you're going to have victory. I have given you the town. And I said, if I told you you would have victory, would you come at that with excitement? Would you have some confidence? Might you believe in yourself and the things that you're doing? And your answer was, yes. So one of two things is the problem, because we've been given victory. I gave you three verses. They're right there. Write them down. Three verses that say you have victory in Jesus Christ. It is already done. So how should we respond? With excitement and confidence, right? So if we come at it instead with defeat, what does that mean? It means we don't believe the promise. God wants us to believe the promise, and he wants us to act like it before he gives us the victory. There's two things he wants us to do, and it's the same thing that he asked Joshua and the Israelites to do. I want you to do three things this week, and one I want you to start thinking about right now. I want you to ask yourself, what is the wall you need God to bring down? What's the wall in your life that you need God to bring down? It might be something personal. It might be something spiritual. It might be something in your family. It might be something financial. Here at the church, we've got a wall we need brought down. It might be a literal wall we need brought down. We're running out of space. And we have $1.5 million worth of debt that I wish we could get rid of. And we talk about it all the time, right? Has God given us victory over that?
Yes.
We got to start acting like it, right? That doesn't mean we do stupid things. It means we do the simple things that God has already asked us to do. What is your wall that you want God to bring down? And then I want you to do two things this week, and they're going to sound weird. I want you to be silent, and I want you to shout. How do we do that? We do them in order. First thing is you got to spend time quietly in God's presence. And I think what this silence really is for most of us is not trying to fix it. It's not saying, God, here's how you can solve, here's how you can bring the wall down. Like, God needs our help. God, if you would do it this way, that would be awesome. And we start building ladders. God doesn't want us to build ladders. God wants us to be silent in his presence. Just be with God. Hear his voice. And then shout because you've already got the victory. Shout before the wall comes down. Start acting like you've got the victory before you have the victory. It's not faith to praise God after he gives you what you want. That's easy, right? Anybody can do that. What's faith is saying, God, I believe you have given the victory, and we're going to start acting like it. We have 5 minutes left in the service. Oh, pastor got done early. No, he didn't. Keep dreaming. Guess what we're going to do with this 5 minutes? We're going to be silent, and then we're going to shout. Did you count how many songs we did this morning? Only three. We don't do three. How many do we do? We do four. We always do four, unless pastor's going to run really long that day. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to give you a moment, and this is going to be uncomfortable for you. Anyone ever tried to be silent in front of God? Anyone ever tried to be silent in our culture? So here's number one. Take this and put it down. Yeah, throw it away. Don't throw it away. It's probably expensive. You sell it if you want to get rid of it. Just give it to me. But put it down, and I just want you to be silent. See, here's what happens when I start doing the silent thing so that you know you're not alone. I start and I sit in silence before God, and I try and do this every morning. 8,000 things come flooding into my head. I can't remember where I put my car keys 5 minutes ago until I sit in silence. And then I'm thinking, okay, they're sitting there and this is going on and that's going on. I can't remember anything until I sit in silence before God. That's why I think it took them 6 days. It's going to take some time. 6 days of silence, 5 seconds of shouting, right? That's going to happen to you. Power through it. And by the way, you don't just do it here. When should you be silent? All week. Spend some time in silence before God, especially if you've got a big challenge. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to be silent before God and just bring him the wall. Collectively, we can bring him the wall that we're standing in front of as a church. And then bring him your wall. Say, God, this is the wall I need brought down. That's it. Don't ask him how. Don't tell him how. Don't ask him when. Leave the methods and the timing and all of that in God's hands. He may ask you to do something crazy like march around the wall. What he'll probably do is ask you to do something simple. And then you'll argue with him. That's okay. Just argue with him and then you'll get on his page, right? That's what the silence is about. So we're going to spend just a moment in silence and then we're going to worship. We're going to shout, okay? So just take, and I'm going to start us in prayer just for a second, and then just be quiet before God. Father, we are here in your presence. We are your kids. We are ready to hear your voice.